Everyone, welcome to 1111 downtown in Fort Worth. I'm Tom McDermott, the pastor of the 1111 community, one of the associates at First United Methodist Church. I'm so glad that you're joining us this morning, and I hope you're doing well. Miss seeing all of you. We'll do that sometime in the near future, but for now, it's good to have you with us in this way. Let us know you're with us, and register your attendance there to the side. You'll see that. Also an opportunity for giving online, and we hope you'll take advantage of that. We appreciate the support in so many ways. And then, if you're watching on Facebook, make sure you let us know, make a comment, but especially like, check the like there so we can know that you're with us. And then if you can, give us a comment and let us know who's with you as well. We've been having great conversations there. So a couple of things are coming up that I want to make sure you know about. This afternoon, very important, our next 90 campaign, the church is going to have an official Zoom meeting, and we're going to vote on the next 90 campaign, which looks at phase one of our two-part camp building campaign. And phase one will include Wesley Hall as well as the groundwork for the larger campus development down the line. You need to get online to register so that you can vote, and we need to have you there present. So right after this is over, go to FUMCFW, look up that graphic you see there, next 90, click it, it will help you register so that you can make your vote known. And then also, while you're there, go ahead and go on over and get the information for the Zoom link for the conversation on Monday night. And that's going to be our Crafting Difficult Conversations with Daryl Parker and myself. And Daryl's going to be talking to his daughter, Kagan, a young adult who used to sing with us in the 1111 band. and some interesting things that they're discovering together. I got to listen to part of that conversation. I know that you're going to enjoy it as well. And so hope you'll join us tomorrow at 7 o'clock for an hour of crafting difficult conversation. Listen, I'm starting a new series today, and we're going to be interviewing different people every week. This morning, I'm starting with my first interview with Reverend Linda McDermott, and I'll give you more details on that. But I want to give you a scripture reading to get us started. And this is a scripture. This scripture comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 17 through 22, the rich young ruler and his encounter with Jesus. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him and said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony or defraud or dishonor, you shall honor your father and your mother." "Teacher," he said, "all of these things I've been doing since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and then said lovingly, "Then there's one thing you lack. Go and sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and then you will have treasure in heaven. Come and then follow me." And the man's face fell, and he went away sad because he had great wealth. I wanted to read this now because later on, as we get into it this morning a little later, you'll see that I kind of got my scriptures a little bit mixed up, and or the text a little mixed up. But the story ends the same way and begins the same way. So I just wanted to make sure you knew that I already knew that, so that you're not going to contact me and say, you got the scripture associations wrong there. So we're covered. Listen, we're going to have a great time this morning. Got some great music coming up, and then my discussion with Reverend Linda McDermott. So glad to have you with us. We'll see you soon.
Good morning. Please join with us in reciting our welcome.
Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving. It doesn't matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times, come yet again.
And there is peace in the broken.
Hey everyone, you're listening to Elizabeth Wills singing her song In the Broken. And just a beautiful song, one of her most popular, but such a profound one. She's done for us personally, in person at 1111 before.
It's probably of all... It's among the top three of Elizabeth's pieces and one of my favorite all-time songs.
Such a powerful message.
Peace in the broken.
What's the refrain on that?
There's peace in the broken. There's peace in the fall. And if your heart is open, you're not empty at all, which I love that.
The series that we're starting now, this new series that I'm starting, is entitled Peace in the Broken, Living in the Question. As we find ourselves... 7 months now, 8 months into this COVID reality, but all of the other attendant disastrous kinds of things that are happening in relation to it, just personally, socially, and maybe even spiritually for you. But what we want to think about are those kinds of questions that have broken us open. As I said at the welcome, 1111 is really about questioning answers, always opening up ourselves enough to be in a place of unknowing, not to simply destroy or upend just for the sake of upending, deconstructing just for the sake of that, but to expand our relationship to where we are. Because life is always changing, right?
Change is the name of the norm.
Oh my gosh.
And especially we're aware of it now when we really don't know from week to week. Are we going to open? Are we not? Is my job going to be... There's so much that... Flexibility and adapting to change is a real important coping skill.
I know some of you are dealing with new jobs. We've got school happening now. We've got empty nesting for college students going away from home.
And lots of change.
Lots of change. One of the things that you do, I always love, you're such a fine teacher, and you have such a great grasp of teaching people, empowering people to learn, whereas I'm kind of I love to come in and sort of yank carpets. You love to just sort of help people find their way. Anyway, what is it that you do sometimes when you introduce these concepts that are threatening?
I do like to teach biblical authenticity. And sometimes that, for people who don't know, that's very threatening. And so sometimes you have to kind of ease them into some new concepts. And what I often do is just ask them, look, I'm going to ask you a question that at one time would have got you excommunicated from the church or even killed. There were people who died because they dared to ask this particular question. So I'm going to ask you, do you think that the earth is the center of the universe or solar system?
Huh.
Now, people, nobody raises their hand. They just laugh at me. And I'm like, but that question was so threatening to people's, a lot of people's foundation of their faith and mm-hmm. the church and their confidence in the church.
We call that a geocentric orientation to reality or understanding.
Right? I didn't geocentric, realize earth-centric, that, but I should have.
As opposed to heliocentric, the way that things are.
Thank you. Anyway.
Yes.
The point being, somebody had to raise that question.
Yeah.
And that broke open a whole new reality.
Things we just
but
take for granted.
But look at the resistance.
Yeah.
For centuries.
Yeah.
And now we laugh at it like, who the heck thought that was such an important deal?
Right. There are things that, there are questions, there are moments in our lives, there are things that happen in events, personally, socially, like pandemics even, that challenge us to rethink the way we see things.
And that is so important.
And so that's really what this series is about, how we can live in these questions without anxiety in a way that enlarges us, empowers our spirituality, and enlarges our relationship with life, God, with one another. So we thought this next song would be perfect because of these very questions you often raise, introduce in the classes.
I love this.
Peter Mayer, Brad's going to do this song.
Another beautiful,
entitled,
beautiful lyrics.
A great question entitled, which we give to you as we start this series, Do You Really Want to Know?
Do you?
The sun once went around the earth, according to the Holy Church, which helped to reassure people that they were the center of the universe. One day His Holiness the Pope met a man with a telescope. Said, Mr. Galilee, what does your spyglass say? And the scientist spoke. He said, it's really quite amazing. Entirely life-changing. So let me ask before I show you, do you really want to know? Oh, do you really want to know? Emma read the Bible for direction. She said she was a child of heaven, and that the human race came from a higher place, from the angels descended. She wound up marrying her cousin. He was a thinker of a husband. Lost in thought she'd find him. Hey Charlie, what you writing? Darwin looked up and spoke. He said, it's really quite amazing. Entirely life-changing. So let me ask before I show you, do you really want to know? Do you really want to know? Do you really want to? And let knowledge like a breeze in through the door of your belief, blow through the rooms and the corridors, not cherish heirlooms to the floor. That wind can raise a roof sometimes and leave you blinking at the sky. So if you stare into this glass, beware that there's no going back. You'll see sunrise, but it will refuse. Instead, the earth itself will move and spin you round from dawn to dawn. A amid the wonder of it.
Thanks, Brad. That is such a good song. It asks such a great question, and Peter Mayer does a really great job with telling that narrative.
Yeah,
really nice. So I'm going to start off with the first question. Same questions, basically, I'm going to ask all of my guests, okay, with a little twist to each one of them, a little more contextually related to you distinctively. But and I know you well, so that's going to be fun to hear you tell this story. But
you do know me.
I do know you well. Yeah, boy, do I know you well. Oh. So, this is the question. Share with us. Share with all of us the spiritual ground root of your story, sort of like your childhood spiritual story.
Oh, okay.
What was your childhood religious life like?
Okay. It was, I was raised in the church, the United Methodist Church. My family was there every Sunday, and I would say it wasn't a particularly progressive church, but it was a church that emphasized grace and God as love, and that I, as a child, I would say sort of the foundation of what I believed was that I was loved by God, and that it was my expectation that I would try to love others.
Mm-hmm.
So that was probably the grounding of that. But juxtaposed with that was my dad, who was a scientist, and scientist by nature will question everything, even certitude is still in the theory realm. It's always open, or you're not a true scientist. I remember him telling me that. And there was a moment, there's a memory where my dad had taken my family out in the middle of the night, which he did on a fairly regular basis, to look through a telescope and look at the stars and see something that was happening that night, probably a meteor shower. And I remember him trying to explain infinity to me, and or the stars that just went on and on and on. And my little 5-6-year-old brain was having a real hard time with that. And then I remembered that morning, my Sunday school teacher had told me that God knew me so well that God knew my name. And
wow.
I remember asking my dad, so the God that created these billions of stars is the same God who knows my name? And that just kind of blew me away.
Yeah.
I literally remember that I felt like I couldn't breathe. I felt a little bit like I was suffocating.
It is a little overwhelming.
Just overwhelming to me.
Yeah, especially if I can see that, especially if you're really connected to your father in a way that sort of looks up to his wisdom.
Oh, very
and,
much
and
so.
And now he's saying you're part of something so massive, so mysterious, so amazing.
Yeah,
so,
and yet so personal.
Yeah.
So connected to my very essence of my being.
Well, I know your father well, and one of the things that I loved about your father was his own interest in certitude, because he was a scientist, but also this love for mystery, right?
Yeah.
He had this, I mean, we'd have just the greatest conversations that just would go on, and we just had to stop, because it was like every question, you know, just opened up.
And that's,
what was that he said to you?
Well, I remember asking him one time, Dad, if science gets so advanced, will we stop needing God? And he kind of chuckled, he laughed. Not at me, but he found it very humorous. He said, oh, Linda, every time we learn something new, it opens the door to hundreds, if not thousands and thousands of new things we didn't ever know we didn't know. So, no, I don't think science will ever get to the point where we don't need the mystery.
Which is really, I mean, for scientists, that's an interesting thing to hear scientists say that. And I wanted to think.
No, I mean, remember that every scientist is looking for certitude, but certitude almost always falls under the realm of theory. So it's never so certain that you can't question it, or it ceases to become a true science. It becomes a bias.
Yeah.
My dad was, that was very important to him.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Well, I want to ask you a question about certitude. To kind of get us into this, I wanted to tell a story from the New Testament. Jesus is teaching a crowd. I believe this is in the Gospel of Matthew and a couple of the Gospels, but he's teaching a crowd as usual. And the crowd represents, you know, always represents sort of the various strata mm-hmm. of society, mm-hmm. right? Poor to wealthy mm-hmm. and Pharisees to everyone. So Jesus has this crowd, and a man comes up, interrupts him in teaching. It's the rich young ruler.
Okay.
And he asks him, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" Which we understand that to mean not heaven so much as, how do I get right with God?
How do I get right with
mm-hmm. with life?
Mm-hmm.
How do I find out I really do belong, essentially? If he mm-hmm. could really get to this unconscious, that would be what it is.
Okay.
And so Jesus says to him, "Do you know the law?" "Yeah, I do it all. I'm always practice it. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind," from the Old Testament, "and love your neighbor as yourself." Jesus says, "Good. Only one thing left. Go and sell all you have, give to the poor, and follow my way of life. Follow me in my way of life." And it says, it's mm-hmm. such a vivid description. It says he turned and walked away sad, for he had a lot of wealth.
Wow, yeah.
You know?
It's almost as though when he asked Jesus the question, you wonder if it was more phrased like, "But don't you think that it's enough?" Or,
yeah.
I mean, when I teach classes, we don't even, that's not a legitimate question. To say, "But don't you think," is not a question. It's
right.
a seeking certitude for what came, I already
if
think.
If he came to Jesus for confirmation on what he already
yeah.
understood, which
yeah.
is what a lot of us do, a lot of people we know do in terms of our religious life, we look for like-minded folks, or we look for mm-hmm. groups that sort of confirm our bias because of our own discomfort.
Right.
And asking questions
well,
is an invitation to being broken open a little.
Ah,
you know, I mean,
it's
an invitation
yeah.
to being broken open. It's like Jesus saying, Peter Mayer saying, "Do you really want to know?" Jesus could have easily said, "Wait a minute, are you sure you want to know what you're asking?"
So the first answer, yeah, he assumed that part. The second one maybe wasn't a universal answer that Jesus would have given everybody, but for this
yeah.
young man, his wealth was the thing that was going to shake his foundations.
Well, I think that's a good point that you make, that it wouldn't necessarily be the same for everyone.
But what is it that would shake up your certitude? What would open you?
Yeah.
What would break you open?
Yeah. You know, and it's interesting, you know, Emma Wedgwood, who married Charles Darwin, she was a devoutly religious person.
This was in the Peter Mayer song.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it says that in the song. And then Charles Darwin was an agnostic
okay.
as a scientist, and progressively increasingly so. But one of the things that she acknowledged in a letter was that our differences are wide. This was before they got married.
Mm.
But there's something that supersedes all that, that bridges
she
all of that.
She was a woman of faith.
She's a woman of faith,
and
he was agnostic. And they had very different opinions
okay.
about that.
Wow. They still got together.
Yeah, but she said, "I belong to you now, and you belong to me now."
Mm.
I mean, she used those words in her letter. "You belong to me. I belong to you." It's as if that belonging, how do you live in the midst of this mystery?
Mm.
Right? They were both willing to be broken open, to let go of some of their need for, "You have to think like I think."
Right.
"You have to be like I am."
Well, you know what? What you're saying, I think, is kind of what I had said about my childhood faith. They were rooted in love, not shared answers. And my faith journey as a child was rooted in the belief that I was loved, that I loved God, God loved me,
yeah,
and others. But
so you had this certitude of how God was, or how God was, and how you were related to God growing up, and a big part of that was belonging. The rich young ruler needed some kind of certitude, some kind of confirmation, and wasn't willing to know what really he needed to do, wasn't willing to let go of that. So that being broken open was too frightening for him, for example. What in your life, this is the second question, what in your life, or has there been something in your life that has broken you open in such a way that it's challenged all your certitudes and reoriented your how you look at life and certitude in general when it comes to faith? Does that make sense?
I think there have been moments, but there was a particular moment that I would say I could name as my broken. I was broken open. And at the time it was painful, but I had gone through high school. I really went a much more conservative Christian route, and I was enjoying, because my growing up church was still fairly fluid about what we believed, and you had to believe this. And so going to a much more fundamentalist church, I was impressed in the beginning that they had such certitude. It didn't leave a lot of things to be answered, and that was appealing to me as a teenager. Mm-hmm. And I understand that as part of our journey, but I had been coming more, accumulating these, this is right, this is wrong, this is what you do, this is what you don't do, these are the people who are in, these are the people who are out, that kind of thing. And then we were at UT, and a couple of things were causing some chinks in this, I think rooted back into my childhood, but still. I took a Bible course at UT from a Disciples of Christ pastor and doctor, Dr. Cox, and he was so loving and so gentle and compassionate, and yet what he was teaching was, in my mind, wrong. And so for me, I was trying to put this together. How could this man who's so wonderful be a Christian when he doesn't believe the things that Christians are supposed to believe? Mm-hmm. That's what I had come to think. Mm-hmm. And so, but he just was so impressive as a human being. And I remember, Tom, I was walking across the West Mall. I can tell you where I was. I can tell you what I was wearing. It was what I would consider sort of a Damascus Road experience. It hit me that hard. I had walked past the same booth on the West Mall every day that semester and yeah. for probably years. And there was a booth with gay and lesbian
various
students.
Various student groups out there.
Yeah. Various. Anti-war, all kinds of things. Yeah. This was the gay and lesbian. And for me at that time, that was just wrong.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And, you know, they
walk
were wrong.
On the other side.
I kind of crossed to the other side of the road. And I was in the midst of looking at them and crossing to the other side of the road when I did a double take, because they're sitting behind the booth, enjoying himself, laughing, having a cup of coffee, was Dr. Cox with these outcasts
mm-hmm.
and sinners.
Mm-hmm.
And it so struck me.
I mean, it's a Jesus story, right?
I thought to myself, or something hit me, if Jesus was here, that's where he would be, and you are wrong. Mm-hmm. And your understanding of Jesus is wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that for me was, what happened was I stopped doing all the things, going to the groups I was going to, I stopped all of that, and I remember telling people that the only thing I felt certain of was that there was a God, and that that God was love.
So,
and I started over.
So at that point, you literally that sort of...
I broke open.
It broke everything open.
I let go of all of it.
Yeah, and just had to figure it out.
I said, I don't know anymore.
Yeah, and that's so hard. That process of reorienting is such a challenge, I think. Once that certitude is broken open, it doesn't just suddenly happen that we're like, okay, I can live with the mystery now.
It took a lot of things with it. I don't know what kind of gave me the courage, except that it was kind of a God moment. I really felt like I'd been slapped.
Mm.
So, but I was broken open in such a way that I began to see God in new and different ways that were much better and felt more authentic to who God really was as a God of love. I wouldn't be a pastor today if that hadn't happened to me. I'm afraid I wouldn't even maybe be a Christian, because having those answers just tended to get more and more and more narrow to the point where it was going to become so shallow as to not be particularly even meaningful.
Yeah, we can often talk about when our ideas get so narrow and so fixed that they're not really alive.
I think that's where
I
was.
When we talk about idolatry, it's not really alive.
I knew what I believed, but I didn't wasn't
ideals
really living
that become
it.
Idols become lifeless. Mm-hmm. So I was thinking about all of this, and it made me think about that kayak experience
yeah.
I had couple of weeks ago. I was invited to go out on a moonlight kayak ride out on the bay area, and we're talking about Lake Michigan. Well, it had been a really windy day.
It was
day.
A windy day. I was kind of worried about it.
It had calmed down by the by the evening, but not a lot. There was still lots of waves and a heavy, you know, strong current. And I'm not that experienced. I mean, I've been out on the water before.
Yeah,
but
you've kayaked.
I've kayaked. But at any rate, I thought, sure, I got this. And so I was with this person, and as she got in the water, she's pretty experienced.
It's Laura Smith. She's a member of 1111.
We're not going to mention
her name. Not going to mention her name.
Anyway, she was awesome. She just got out there and was like zipping out into the dark. And it's dark.
Yeah.
I mean, except for the moon's coming up over the trees behind us. And so I'm like, okay, I'll be there. I'll catch up. And she's gone. And I can't get off the shore. And the waves keep coming in and just knocking me back. And finally, I'm just going, I'm going for it. And I push out into it, and I'm thrown off.
Oh.
I mean, I'm dumped. And it happened two or three. I'm dumped three times. Finally, I drag the boat up, and I sort of dump out the water. And I'm going like, okay. I'm catching my breath. I notice something. You know, the waves are just being waves. It's not like we have this adversarial relationship. It's just the way things are. Pandemics are just
they
pandemics.
Weren't your enemy.
You know, I mean, things just happen. Life happens.
Right. Right.
And so I decided I need to stop and notice some things, pay attention. And sure enough, there was a rhythm. And as I noticed, every two or three was
we're
a big wave.
Mindfulness.
I was practicing mindfulness in kayaking. And as two or three would come, then a big one, then two or three smaller ones, then a big one. And they were always carrying it out.
Okay.
So I waited for the smaller ones until the larger one came in. And then I jumped on that and went out with it.
Yeah.
So well, I was a master at that point.
And you get some beautiful
pictures. Oh, and then I had mastered it. I got out there. I never did find Laura for, I don't know, 30 minutes. And then here she is. She shows up. And I'm like, where have you been? And so she says, we're about 100 yards away from where we're supposed to be. Go this way. And again, she zips out. Now we're with the current.
Okay. So that's easier.
Yeah, you'd think. But I could not paddle this thing with the current. I just, why is this so hard? And maybe I thought I'd just been out there too long and I was weak. But this shouldn't have been that hard. She was already on the shore.
Mm-hmm.
When I finally got up on the shore, I was so exhausted. I said, I don't know what took me so long. And she was kind of laughing. I pulled the boat up onto the shore and it was full of water. It was still full of water. I didn't know the water was still there. It was in the back, in the aft or the stern or whatever you call it. The water was just literally dragging me.
Wow.
Because I didn't know it was back there. You know, it was, I guess when I dumped it, I didn't look to see that all of it was dumped.
So you're just...
There's no way to know it's back there because it's not going back and forth. It's literally just dragging me.
And this is a metaphor.
Maybe. How do we make our way through this these mysteries, this willingness to be broken open? Part of that has to do with, you know, Carl Jung said, that which remains hidden in our lives, that we are unwilling to explore, often becomes evident as destiny. We see it as destiny.
Okay.
Right, so the things we don't look at sometimes, or we don't begin to take apart in our lives, become part of our patterns, and we just end up reliving these patterns because we think that's just who we are.
They're heavy weights, preventing us from being broken open and experiencing just what Elizabeth was talking about, finding peace in the broken.
It's that willingness to go there.
If your heart is open, to open your heart to something new.
The rich young ruler really could have gotten there. He just wasn't willing to look at the baggage. He wasn't willing to break open enough to
and
let go of that
certainty. And that's why Jesus addressed it to him.
Right.
Wealth was his baggage.
Yeah, yeah.
And we have to know, what is it that we're so afraid of letting go?
What are the weights that we drag around?
Is the whole thing just going to fall apart, like pulling a thread on a weaving... The whole thing's just going to unravel.
Yeah, and
but it isn't.
And it can be scary. And you had that experience with some of the book groups that you were doing. That you had that similar experience where things, you addressed that idea of when things are a little scary. We're afraid of asking some questions.
Well, this was a book by Sue Monk Kidd. It's her newest book, The Book of Longings. And it explores this wonderful female character. But the controversy around the book was because the female character is supposed to be the wife of Jesus. And for a lot of people, that just shook their foundations. You can't have a married Jesus. Now, when she was interviewed, she said, look, I'm not arguing whether Jesus was married or not. I'm asking a what-if question. Because when we ask a what-if question, we're opening up the possibilities to explore. And the interesting thing was in these three groups that I've led now discussing this book, everybody seemed to be at some, once they got a little bit more comfortable with it, with just opening this question up, that it really revealed to them the possibilities around Jesus being so inclusive of everybody, including women, including people who were different. And so, you know, without being able to, once they let go of the need, again, she said answers were not the point. Answering that question, was he or was he not, was never her point. Yeah. And she'd said to this day, I don't know. I do not know, and we will not know. But what if?
So it's really just opening up enough to think about the possibilities,
it's
to see what is there.
Opening your heart to something that might reveal something different. It might not.
Yeah, yeah.
But you can explore it.
Right. And I think maybe that's one of our takeaways from our interview here, from my interview with you, is this idea of certitude is not all it's cracked up to be.
Certitude is not the goal.
Yeah.
Faith and confidence and trust. But that it takes a lot of trust to open your heart.
There's that fine line between certitude and idolatry, and faith is dynamic and relational and looks. And sometimes we have to be willing to ask, is there something dragging me back, holding me back? Is there something I've been carrying around which is making it a little difficult to actually face what I'm dealing with?
Is there something that I think I need as a certitude that maybe I don't?
That maybe you don't need it after all, yeah. So let's close. It's really been great to interview with you. I really enjoyed it. And we could go on and on. We will afterwards.
We probably will.
Yeah. As we deconstruct our time together. But what you read this, you've got this great quote from Rainer Maria Wilke.
Yeah, I wrote it down.
That really is kind of the essence of what this is all about,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, it really is. Live the questions now. Perhaps then someday far in the future, you will gradually, without even noticing it, live your way into the answer.
I like that. Yeah. Yeah. Live the questions now.
And then maybe you'll grow into an answer. But it's that growing that's where all the possibilities lie.
Yeah. So the peace that we find in the brokenness is that willingness to be open. Mm-hmm. And in that process of being open, we find that we're not empty at all.
I love it. Yeah, thank you, great. Elizabeth. Thank you. That was perfect.
So blessings to you all. Brad's going to close with a song that also fits what we're talking about, Doctor My Eyes, great Jackson Brown song, and about seeing and the willingness to see, right, to see what's there. So blessings to you all in this time.
And may you be broken open.
May you be broken open and find the fullness that is there. We'll see you next time.
Doctor, my eyes have seen the years and the slow parade of fears without crying. Now I want to understand. I have done all that I could to see the evil and the good without hiding. You must help me if you can. Doctor, my eyes, and tell me what is wrong. Was I so long. As I have wandered through this world, as each moment has unfurled, I lay waiting to awaken from these dreams. People fall just where they fell. I never noticed them until I got this. Doctor.